understanding things, if you keep mugging up, there is no point of learning at all, right? So let's look at India today, the physical part of India. So what I'll do is I'll be covering the mountain regions today, all the mountains in India, all the mountains and hills in India. So this the list of mountains and hills in India is more than 45, right? I don't know how many of you know that, right? So there are so many of them. So we'll try to cover all those 44 to 45 of them as such. So you know that the Indian region, which is the subcontinental part, which if you look into a Asia map, you will see something like this, right? So huge land area which is jutting out into the oceans, right, with the Arabian Sea and the Bay of Bengal flanking it, and southern on the southern part we have the Indian Ocean, and in the north you will find all this what you call huge Himalayan mountain chain, right? And the land area within which we have all these shades that you are seeing, yellow ochre shades that you are seeing, is the plateau part of it, right, with so many hills in between, right? A major segment is the plateau, right? And then you have the green areas where which are all plain areas or flatter areas. So normally what we do is broadly we divide India into two, the peninsular part and the extra peninsular part. So if you draw a line which is comes somewhere here, right? So the peninsular part will be separate and the extra peninsular part will be separate. The peninsular part is mainly plateauish and highly you can say they are highly deformed rock areas as such. So this will be you can see that there are lots of plateaus here, and most of these plateaus are very old ones. Some of them you will find from Precambrian period to the very recent formations of due to volcanic flows and all, right? So huge formations can be seen. So the landscape is extensive, and you'll find they are normally dry landscape because it is lying on leeward side of the features that are there on the western side and even on the eastern side. So what happens, it remains drier. So most of the plateau regions in India, so you'll find they fall on the drier part of it, right? And so peninsular area, you have, though you have certain hills which are very important, but not when compared to the northern part, the extra peninsular part, where you have huge mountain ranges which are the Himalayas, right? So Himalayas, as you know, these are considered to be recently formed mountains. They are called as young fold mountains, and not which itself is very very important for Indian context from many sides or many angles, we can say, including that of climate. So we'll proceed with various features, mountain features that are there in India. So we'll start with an outline map. I hope all of you have an outline map with you. This is very important for you to go through this particular exercise, right? And I hope things are clear to you as such, because I'll be drawing on this. I'll be enlarging it. Of course, there are a few maps which are a little more larger. I was just showing this so that you know which part we will be dealing with first. So as I said earlier, when we look at all the features that we have, physical features that we have, starting from Himalayas to the coastal plains or the islands, right, on the subcontinental area, we have approximately around 44 plus mountain features, or you can say some of them are hill features, because some of them don't have, some of them are below 5,000 meters of elevation, you can say, right? So more than 44 features you can see which are of hilly in nature. So we'll start with the Himalayas first, which is well known to your easier you for you to understand. So you know that the Himalayan system, let me change the color so that it is, so Himalayan system runs something like this. Right, so it goes up to here. On the westernmost part, you have the Nanga Parbat. I'll just write NP, right? Nanga Parbat, right? So that you can expand it. So this is from where you'll, what you call, the Indus bends southwards. So there is Indus River here. So this is totally 2,500 kilometers in length, which you all might be knowing. Now most of you know this as a single chain, right? As such, it is not a continuous chain. So though the mountains are there, there are lots of rivers which cut across this huge mountain chain, which is probably having a width more than 400 kilometers, right, and a length of 2,500 kilometers. On the west, if it is the Indus River, on the east, you will find it is the Brahmaputra River or Sangpo River, and on the eastern corner, you have Namcha Barwa, right? Namcha Barwa, CHA, right? So it is very difficult to write with a mouse, that is why. Both these are very high mountains. The Nanga Parbat should be approximately 8,000 plus mountain, 8,126 meters high, and the Namcha Barwa is somewhere around 7,756 meters high, I think, right? So if I'm not wrong. So this is the scenario as such. We have a huge mountain chain. Right. So now there are other features as well. So there are lots of features here. So there are lots of features here in this part, and there are lots of features below that. So what I'll do is I'll put this Jammu and Kashmir thing in a little more enlarged format, so that we can know what is there in those areas, and then we'll proceed one by one so that you understand the things much easily. Right, so remember that the entire Himalayas stretch between these two lines, and if you know, you might have always heard that Himalayas are considered to be having syntaxial bends. Do you know what does that mean? Right, so it means a very simple thing, right? So at both these ends, you'll find the Himalayas actually sharply bend southwards. At both the ends, right? they bend sharply southwards, right? Near about, you can say, 90 degree angle, right? They bend, entire mountain ranges bend southwards. So this is why it is called as, this is something that is referred to as syntaxial bends, right? So this is very important thing. Sometimes it can be asked as well. Normally people refer to this arc as syntaxial bend. So that is not the thing, right? Right. So Vinayak, is the screen not full enough?
No problem, sir. കാണാൻ പറ്റും, കുഴപ്പമില്ല.
കാണാൻ പറ്റുമല്ലോ അല്ലെ, കുഴപ്പമൊന്നുമില്ലല്ലോ അല്ലെ, റൈറ്റ്.
പക്ഷേ ചിലവർക്ക് കിട്ടുന്നില്ലെന്ന് പറഞ്ഞു, ഐ തിങ്ക് റേഞ്ചിന്റെ ആയിരിക്കും.
അല്ല, അത് ഒരു പണി ചെയ്താൽ മതി. അവര് എന്താ പറയാ, ചിലപ്പോ ചില ആൾക്കാരുടെ ഇത് വന്നിട്ടുണ്ടാവും. അപ്പൊ ആ പിന്നില്ലേ, അവരുടെ അടുത്ത് ഇന്റെ ഇത് നോക്കിയിട്ട്, ഞാൻ പ്രസന്റ് ചെയ്യുന്നത് നോക്കിയിട്ട് ആ പിന്നൊന്ന് പ്രസ് ചെയ്താൽ മതി. ദെൻ ഇറ്റ് വിൽ റിമെയിൻ ഓൺ ദെയർ ദിസ് പ്രസന്റേഷൻ. അല്ല, റേഞ്ച് ഇല്ലാത്ത ഇഷ്യൂസ് ഉണ്ടാവാം, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഇത് ഇറ്റ് മേ മിസ് ഔട്ട് എന്നുള്ള.
അതുപോലെ സാറേ, നോട്ടിഫിക്കേഷൻ ബാർ ഒന്ന് ഹൈഡ് ചെയ്യാവോ സാർ? ലാസ്റ്റ് ശ്രീലങ്കൻ പാർട്ടി കിടക്കുന്ന
നോട്ടിഫിക്കേഷൻ. ഓക്കെ, റൈറ്റ്, നോ പ്രോബ്ലം. സോ വിൽ പ്രൊസീഡ് വിത്ത് ദസ് ഇൻ ഡീറ്റെയിൽഡ് മാനർ. നൗ ഇതിന്റെ ഫോർമേഷൻ, ഹിമാലയത്തിന്റെ ഫോർമേഷൻസ് ആൻഡ് ഓൾ യു മൈറ്റ് ബി നോയിങ്. ഇറ്റ് സം 2 മില്യൺ ഇയേഴ്സ് ബിഫോർ ഉള്ള പ്രോസസിംഗ് ആൻഡ് ഓൾ യു മൈറ്റ് യു ഹാവ് ലേൺഡ് ത്രൂ പ്ലേറ്റ് ടെക്ടോണിക്സ് എക്സെട്രാ. Right, so this is that processing has created a lot of features as such. Right. Sorry. Just hold on. Okay.
Sir, recording ile sir?
Ah, recording cheyyunnund, recording cheyyunnund. Okay, don't worry.
Okay sir, okay, okay.
So I'll take you to the larger map, then it will be easier, I think. Okay. This is better. So let me, so what I was saying is, so you have the mountain range, something like this, right? And you have the rivers. This is Indus, which is running like this, right? Most of you know the rivers, so I'm not writing the name as of now. Right, so flows like this. Right. So this is Brahmaputra or Sangpo, which runs like this. So now the plate tectonics related things, stuff you are already knowing. So the Indian subcontinental plate, right, came and hit against the Eurasian plate, and which caused the formation of these young fold mountains, and this has created some very interesting features, right? So these features include, like, what you call the thrust lines that are very important, or the fault lines that are there, right? So you have let me draw. So you have the Indus, Sangpo, Suture Zone, right, ITSZ, Indus, Sangpo, Suture Zone. Then you have the in between you have the Tethyan Himalayas. So Tethyan, or maybe Thian, Tethyan, Tethys Himalayas, maybe you can write Tethys Himalayas, right? And then you have this thrust fault here, right, which we normally refer to as the Himadri fault or thrust fault. This is thrust fault. THF, normally that is what is written, right? That is what we normally write. This is called the trans Himadri, that is beyond Himadri, the thrust fault that is there. So beyond Himadri. So this is trans Himadri fault. And then you have the greater Himalayas. After greater Himalayas, you have the main central thrust, MCT, right? So this is between greater Himalayas and lesser Himalayas. And between lesser Himalayas and the Shivaliks or outer Himalayas, what you have is MBT, main boundary fault, MBT, and then still south of it, you have the outer Himalayas or the Shivalik mountains. And you have the HFF. HFF is nothing but the Himalayan frontal fault. And still ahead of it is the what you call four deep that we call, right, which is filled by the sediments brought down by Ganga, Indo-Gangetic plain, that what we refer to as, right, Indus as well as the other tributaries of Ganga and Brahmaputra. So you have huge plain area as well. So this is the normal cross section, right, or the profile as such for this particular mountain ridge, which is very important. And you'll find Tethyan Himalaya does extend even into our Kashmir area, right, the Ladakh Kashmir areas as well. So entire area north of it you'll find is very important. Now this ITSZ is the line which actually coincides with the Brahmaputra and Indus rivers. So that is what we normally call as the suture zone. Suture zone means nothing but the zone where the two continents got welded. So where it has joined together, right? So that is important area as such. Now, normally we divide this into three ranges like this, right? Greater Himalayas, Lesser Himalayas, and Outer Himalayas. Greater Himalayas, you have average height which is above 8000 meters, right? The Lesser Himalayas are also not smaller. They also have very good height as such, right? So you'll find 6500 to 7000 meters of average height is there. Now, outer Himalayas are much smaller, so average height is 2500 to 3000 meters, right, wherein maybe few peaks are there which do go beyond the average limits, right? So this is very important from perspective of your examination, because these fault lines, all these things are normally asked. So this is a regular thing in most of the examinations normally conducted by UPSCs and all. So you'll find this to be very crucial, right, when it comes to India segment, especially that which is dealing with the Himalayas, right? the width wise, if you look, it is the central portion where that is mainly above our Bihar, the state of Bihar or Uttar Pradesh, those areas, or Nepal. Those are the areas where Himalayas have maximum width. And as it goes towards west and east, you will find it is comparatively narrow. But there are mountains here in the western side which are beyond the Himalayas, which we normally refer to as Trans-Himalayan mountains, which makes it much broader in the west. So we think that it is also part of Himalayas. As such, it is not. Right. So there are some ranges which do go beyond the Indus River as well, which has connections with, or which is of same period of origin as that of the Himalayas, right? And it gets connected with the roof of the world, which is called as Pamir Knot, right? So think why it is called Knot. So from here you have Hindu Kush, you have the what you call Karakoram ranges, then you have the Tian Shan, and you have the Kunlun Shan. So, right, Kunlun Mountains, etc., all of them rise from this Pamir Knot. So, that is, and there are so many other smaller ranges also, and that is why it is referred to as the roof of the world, right? So, and it's a very high plateau, right? It is more than 7,000 meters average height is there. Right? Even Tibet is only, average height is only 5,000 meters as such. Right. So what I'll do is I'll go to this particular section and we'll look at the mountain ranges that are there, which are very important, because in, last year also I think there was a question from this particular section with mountain ranges, and you were supposed to identify, or the candidate was supposed to identify, the altitude wise arrangement of that particular a listed mountain. So this was a tricky question, because unless and until you know this region, you will not be able to answer that question as such. So let's look into that. So this is a better map, I think, which will be clearer to you as such. So so we have, let me take the, so this is where the Himalayas are there, right? This is where the Himalayas are running. So there are many ranges that are go into our, and so I'm just drawing one line so that it doesn't become cluttered. So this is the Himalayas, and here we have, sorry, so here we have the Nanga Parbat, right? Nanga Parbat. Again, it's an 8,000er. Remember, this is now, this is as of now not under Indian administrative control. This is in Pak occupied Kashmir, right? And this is where you'll find the Indus takes the southerly turn and flows out. Now, beyond this, that is north of this Himalayas, there are three major ranges which are very important. Right. So one is the Karakoram ranges. Right. Karakoram range. This again starts from the Pamir Knot area and extends into this one, and then this range keeps on going like this, smaller and smaller, and it gets connected with the or merged with the smaller hills that are extending from Kunlun Shan and other Tibetan hills, right? So here, somewhere in the middle of it, you also have so somewhere in the middle of it, you have the K2, right, which is the highest peak, is also called Godwin Austen. So there are 6 to 8 peaks they that have been named, like K1, K2, K3, K4. Right. So 8 peaks are there which are above, I think, 8,000 meters. All very high and very dangerous climbing points. And so there are people who climbed that as well, right? So one are considered to be one of the dangerous mountains to be climbed. So here is K2, which is this forms the northernmost mountain range for India as is, right? And when we look at the highest peaks in India, if a question comes, this it is supposed to be K2. Though it is not at presently, it is at presently located in the Pak occupied Kashmir part of India, right? Even this one. Right? Now, just south of it, we have the Ladakh range. Let me put this into. So you have. Which is on the northern side of Indus. Ladakh range, and south of it, south of Indus, you have the Zaskar range, right? This is Ladakh and this is Zaskar. Right, Zaskar, I think the highest it is also loftiest. It is more than 7,000 meters at certain locations. Mount Comet is the highest peak in on Zaskar, and the Kardungla Pass and such kind of things are located on the Ladakh range, right? So this is again a very important section, right? Now, the coming to the southern part of it, that southern the Kashmir section of it, or Jammu and Kashmir section of it, so you have a very important mountain ranges here. This will be very thickly. This has to be very thick. Himalayas. This is huge range, huge thickness. So it goes in many ways. So there is a range that runs like this in an oblique manner, right? It gets connected because there are all parts of Himalayas here, so it runs in an oblique manner here, and in between this and the Himalayas, right, the Himalayan ranges, you have huge Himalayas here, right? These are all part of Himalayas. So in between this, so this gets connected like this. So you have a small opening also is there, I think, so if I'm not wrong. Like this. So this is the Pir Panjal Mountains. This is Pir Panjal Mountains. Pir Panjal Mountains, right? And in between Pir Panjal and the what you call Himalayas, you have this section which we call as Kashmir Valley, right? So Kashmir Valley, this is the valley portion as such, right? And just south of it, just south of Pir Panjal, I'll use another color so that it is easier for you to understand. Just south of Pir Panjal, somewhere here, somewhere here you have the Dholadhar ranges. Dholadhar ranges. I hope you will be able to write that. I'm not writing the name. Dholadhar, right? Dholadhar. So this is which extends from the Kashmir area towards Himachal Pradesh, right? And then merges with the main Himalayan region, right? And just south of it, you have somewhere here where the Shimalik Mountains start, right? This is Shimalik Mountains. Shivaliks. So Shimalik Mountains. It is very difficult to write with the mouse, but still I hope you'll be able to understand. Right. Now this entire area here, this is called the Aksai Chin Plateau. Right. So it's a very high plateau, normally above 4000 meters of elevation. Right. So which is again, this is under this part is again not with us. It is all the conflicts that are happening are somewhere here. And the location is somewhere here, Galwan River and all, right? Which is part of this particular river. This is the Shyok River, so it is a tributary to that particular river, I think. So this maybe some other class we'll be looking at this. So there is a huge plateau here, which is very important, which is called as Aksai Chin, right? And somewhere just south of it, in between the Himalayan areas, just north of our Kashmir Valley, somewhere in between here, right? So there is a small plain area which is referred to as Deosai Plains. Deosai Plains. There is Deosai Mountains also just north of it, a oblique mountain. So Deosai Plains, right? Again, very, very important plain, which is, this is also a well-known, national park, but not of India. I think it is as of now in POK, right? But it's well-known spot for birds and all during the seasons. You know, migratory birds and all do come here. It's a huge area as such, right? So these are the very important features that are there in the northern part, the trans-Himalayan areas and the Himalayan mountain ranges, right? So here normally they do ask, so the last time they had asked based on altitude. Now they can also ask based on arrangement. Maybe they will ask north to south arrangement or south to north arrangement, right? So, or east to west. So they can give you a list of these mountains and then make you write it in different this. So altitude wise you'll find the question was Karakoram, Ladakh, Zaskar and Pir Panjal, which one of them? So what is the altitudinal organization from sea level of these mountains? So the answer is actually Karakoram, then the Ladakh, Zaskar and Pir Panjal ranges. So these are, this is how it comes through, right? A very, very important thing. So like that, so the questions can be come in a twisted manner, right? So okay, so So we have seen this particular area. Now as we go towards east, so normally what happens is that Himalayas have also been longitudinally divided. So you have the Kashmir Himalayas, right? The Kashmir Himalayas between River Indus. I'll just rub that. River Indus and Satluj. Then between Satluj and Yamuna, you have the Himachal Himalayas. Himachal Himalayas. Right, HH. Then between Yamuna and River Kali, right, there is a river that is flowing right here along the border, which is a tributary of one of the major tributaries of Ganga. So this is called Kumaun and Garhwal Himalayas. Then between River Kali and the Kosi River, right? So River Kosi, Kosi, it is called as Nepal Himalayas. Nepal Himalayas. Then between Kosi and you have the Tista River, right? Tista. Tista is another important river, which is again one of the swiftest rivers of India, normally used for whitewater rafting and all. So between this Tista, you have the Sikkim Himalayas. And from here, between Tista to Brahmaputra, it is either called Assam Himalayas or it is called as Arunachal Himalayas. Right. In between, you have an area which is normally referred to as Bhutan Himalayas. Right. So you can even bifurcate that. So Bhutan Himalayas. And then you can. So there is no major river to tell you which divides it. So probably there might be, but I'm not aware of it. Maybe I'll have to check it. Right. So this is normally referred to as Bhutan Himalayas. Bhutan is one of the countries which is lying mostly in Greater Himalayan part. Remember that. So it is there is a part of it in only a small part of it in Lesser Himalayas. And very little in the Shivalik ranges, but maximum part is in the Greater Himalayan area, right? And then the Arunachal Himalayas. So Arunachal Himalayas, on the easternmost part, you have Namcha Barwa. Again, Namcha Barwa is not in India, CHA, right? Namcha Barwa. This is again 7000 plus meters high. So where again the entire mountain system bends southwards in a very sharp manner. And all those which are lying outside this, these are different hills. They are not part of we don't normally call them to be this part of this system. So this is totally, process might have been same or time period might have been same, but it is a totally different kind of system as such, right? So this is how it is. So there is nothing much to be dealt here in this particular area. Now some of the hill stations you can always look into, especially in this area, right? As especially Mussoorie, the Dehradun, Ranikhet or Nainital or such kind of locations. Now they do ask which part of Himalayas they fall into, whether they are in the outer Himalayas, lesser Himalayas, etc. So this is something that normally goes into. And then there are national parks and such kind of things, which maybe some other class we can deal with, lots of passes, etc. Right. So those things can be dealt in a different manner, because there are lots of things to talk about them as well. Right. So today let's stick on to our the major part of locating these spatially, at these mountain systems spatially. So let's move further. So this let's move into the northeastern part so that we'll cover up those areas. Now here in the greater Himalayan segment, somewhere here along border with Nepal, India, right? So this area, right, Nepal and India, you have Kanchenjunga. Right, Kanchenjunga. Very difficult to write, but still there. Kanchenjunga is again an 8000, a very important peak, bordering. So one side is in Nepal and another side is in the India part. Now this is also, why I'm saying this, this is also a World Heritage Site. So now here the World Heritage Site from both senses, that is natural site as well as a cultural site. So because of the people who live there, so their culture also has been recognized. So this is the only site, I think, which has been given both the tags by in India, with both natural and cultural heritage of India, right? So that is very important. Now, there is a swift river that rises from here and flows down and joins Brahmaputra, right? Brahmaputra comes down, something like this. So this is called Tista. This is one of the fastest rivers that you have in India. So it starts forming, you can say, delta somewhere here itself. So it spreads out in these areas. So especially Siliguri, those areas and all, lot of floods and all are caused by this particular river. Right? Now coming to the east, right? So coming to the east, it is very important. So you already know that Shivaliks do come up to here, right? Shivaliks do come and keep on stretching like this in the southern part, right? So here in the what you call Arunachal part, the Shivaliks are not called Shivaliks as such, or the foothills are called as Dafla hills, right? So they are called as Dafla hills. Dafla hills. And you have the Brahmaputra flowing like this, and you have the greater Himalayas and all here, Namcha Barua is somewhere here, and here on the eastern side of this river, this particular section, you have the Mishimi hills. So this area, you can say this is, it's a huge broad segment which gets connected with the Arakan Yoman mountains here, which are running right along the Indian border. So it's in this region is entirely mountainous, and it is called as Mishimi hills. So this normally what happens is that people do get confused, so with the other rivers. So here you have the Dibang Valley, Dibang River, Dibang and all, Dibang is part of Mishmi area or Mishmi mountains, right? So it is a very dense area as such. So here what you have is the Brahmaputra entering. So there are so many rivers, the river called Lohit, which is joining Brahmaputra from the east, actually rises from this particular area, Mishmi hills. There are so many other rivers also which rise from the north and join the what you call Brahmaputra from northern part. From south there are very less number of rivers. Now you should also look at the what you call map of Arunachal Pradesh if you get time. Especially look for the number of dams that are there in what you call Arunachal Pradesh. So in case you are not able to find, I'll share a map with you, right, sometime later. So first think about it and maybe search for it, and you'll be surprised to see the number of dams that are there in Arunachal Pradesh. And still what we have is huge floods in what you call Assam Valley, right? So you can think about what dams, whether the dams have been able to control floods as such, right? So that's a good thought to look at when we are discussing about this, right? Now coming to other regions, northeastern regions. Now here you have we looked at Mishmi as such. So let me just clear this so that I have. Little more space to work on. So, I'll draw this river here, which that is Brahmaputra, just to get the scales right, so that you also understand the actual location of mountains. So there are so many rivers. So here you have the Mishmi Hills, which I'm just writing MH. Right, just south of it, along the Arakan Yoma, you have the Patkai Bum. Actually, Patkai Bum stretches from here to directly up to here, but they are known by different names, right? So it is called Patkai Bum. Patkai. Now here this actually stretches. So stretches like this, it goes like this up to here, up to this particular place. Right, so it goes like this. Now, so this is all along, and there is a lot of rolling hills here, right, which are associated with this Patkai Bum thing. Right now, the areas that are there in Nagaland are of this Patkai Bum are referred to as Naga Hills. Then the areas that are there in Manipur are referred to as Manipur Hills. Manipur Hills, and then you have the Mizo Hills. Can anyone think about a different name or another name for Mizo Hills? It is called Lusai Mountains. Lusai. Right. Lusai. Lusai Hills. Lusai Hills, right? Very, very important again. Patkai Bum. I think there has to be an H also. Bum. Right. Now, so this is here. And then you have one mountain or one hill which is lying separately. This is called the Maikir Mountains. M. Maikir. So this is in the Assam plains itself. You'll find a huge hill which is called Maikir Hills, M-I-K-I-R, right? Huge hills that are there. Then you have the Meghalaya Plateau here, which is again very important plateau. And there are three different set of hills here in the southern part. The Garo, Khasi and Jaintia. Right? Garo, Khasi and Jaintia. Now, these are very important because one of the most important factors is the depositions of limestone. And if you remember, very recently, right, the geological time scale, the International Geological Time Scale Authority, so they're the people who are dealing with it, the Stratigraphy Society, it is, as such it is called, right, they have included one of the small periods from this particular area, where the evidence came from this particular area, and it is called as Meghalaya period. You can check with your you can just mail Google it, Meghalaya period, and you will find. So, in the limestone deposits, they were able to find some evidences, geological evidences, which has been included as of now in the zone. So this this area is very very rich in resources. You have coal, which is available in nice good amount, and you might have if you are listening to news and all, you every day you'll find there are several accidents that are caused in this area, especially mine accidents, because rat hole mining is also common here, right? Wherein there is no people themselves doing mining. There is no organized mining, so the people themselves go and do mining. They get into depths of earth, and they try to mine out coal. So the several accidents do happen as well in this particular area, right? So a huge importance. And these Garo, Khasi, and Jaintia, these hills are named after the tribes that they live there. And you are Mausinram, Chirapunji, all those things are here only, right, in these locations. Now, there is one more hill that is very important, which runs somewhere like this. It is called the Barail Range. Barail Range, right, or Barail Hills. So this is the northeastern part, right? So let me also give you some more insight into this particular area where you have the largest island formation, right, River island formation. Hope some of you are aware about it. So there is a river called Subansiri, right? So where the Subansiri is joining, so you'll find a huge island is formed, right? So huge island, because the Subansiri branches out, and then this island is the largest island that you have, which is called Majuli, right? Majuli Island. Interesting. So this, then there are few rivers which are very important. Lohit, which stretches from Mishmi Hills. I'll just write it here. Lohit River. You have Siang. Siang is another river that flows down. Siang, Siang, right? Siang. Okay. So this is all about what we can talk here. So then you can also look here somewhere, because there are lots of troubles going on along the Tripura border. There is a small stream. I'm not remembering the name. Maybe you can check it, which is part of current affairs related issues. So there is a small stream which forms boundary between India and Bangladesh, right? Okay, now let me go back to another slide. So I'll just, let's see. Okay, this is good enough. Another cross-sectional thing that you should be remembering always, and which is normally asked, is the if you remember, this is the Shivalik Mountains, or the foothills, the outer Himalayas, we can say. And just south of it, just south of you have the Tarai area. Sorry, the Babbar area, right? It is called Babbar, right? Where boulders, colluvium is there, right? Babbar. So it is a small belt, right? You can say small belt here, which forms huge colluvial deposits. So it is there, it extends. And some places you may not find, but still it is there, because where the rivers start entering into the flatter plain areas, right? And just south of it, just south of the Babbar area you have. Let me change the color. And just south of it, you have the Tarai. So there is a belt here which forms the. I am just drawing a little broader so that you understand where it is. So you have a belt. So where, no, the Babbar is the place, or Koluvim is the place where rivers disappear, and they tend to reappear here in the Tarai area. Now this is a swampy area where you have there is forest cover, but more than forest cover, you'll find there is a huge growth of grass, right? Something like elephant grass. You will find a huge grass, long grass growing on a lot of swampy areas. And this region, Tarai region, is well known for lots of our national parks, which are located Dudhua, be it Dudhua or be it Valmiki Tiger Reserve. So many of them are located on this, be the Manas Tiger Reserve here, right? So you have the Jaldapara, the Kuch Behar, those areas, right? So there are so many of them are located because this is wildlife rich, biodiversity rich area. Now just south of this you have the Babbar Bangar area, right? So this goes something like this. So this is the Bangar area, right? And then you have the Khaddar area, right? Khaddar area. Let me just switch on my. So this again is the another longitudinal division, because this again is normally asked. So this is Bangar, right? Bangar BH maybe, right? Bangar, right? So Bangar. So this order is also normally asked in these examinations. So be clear with this. So you have the Babbar. You have the Tarai, then you have the Bangar, and then you have the Khaddar. Khaddar is starts where the delta formation starts. So delta formation starts much higher than what we think is. It is not here. It starts where the river starts splitting up. So Hooghly splits up much north of where the actual Sundarbans are there. Right. So the entire region forms a huge delta. Right. So this is the apex of the delta is here, right? The where the Hooghly River is bifurcating. So I hope this thing is clear to you. I'll just clear the screen so that we can go to the other things, right? Okay. So I hope this side we are through. Now one very important feature in the eastern part which I don't want you to miss is somewhere here. Right, so there is a small hill here which is called the Raj Mahal Hills. Now these are upwarped mountains. Right, so I don't know how many of you have heard about this upwarped mountains. So this is something like. So let's imagine this is the crust of the earth, right? And you have the plumes that are there from the interior, right? The magmatic plumes that are there, that is, they come up, right? So what they do is they push the crust and try to crack it and come out. So in these cases, in the case of Raj Mahal Hills and few other hills, just like Vindhyas, what has happened is the crust has bent, right? So crust has become something like this, right? And below you have this plume occupying it, right? So because of heat, crust has bent, but it has not broken, and the lava has, or the material has not come out or the magmatic material has not come out. So there is a huge blister that has formed on the surface of the earth. So these kinds of mountains are normally referred to as upwarped mountains. So you have a lot of granitic stuff that is visible. Now, because of erosion, you will find Raj Mahal Hills, lots of this granitic stuff is clearly visible. The bedrock is visible. The surface crust areas, a lot of it has eroded off, right? So this is where our Ganga takes suddenly turn. So Raj Mahal Hills, right? Raj Mahal Hills. So this is a huge plume that had come up and got stuck. It did not come out and spread. So this is again some 70 to 120 million years. In between that, these things have probably happened, right? So huge area. And similarly, the entire Vindhyan Mountains also, the formation is of same kind, right? So it is a huge blister formation as such. So these two in India are normally referred to as upwarped mountains, right? So I don't know, for some of them this information might be totally new as such. Let me rub this. So Raj Mahal Hills, that is on the easternmost part, right? Now let's go to the westernmost part, right? So western part, as you know, there is normally everyone says that there is only one major mountain thing. Now so if you see this, somewhere here it starts, right? So it goes like this, which we normally refer to as Aravallis. So this lies in four different pieces, right? So this is in four different pieces. There is one very small one here, right? The small one here is referred to as Abu Hills, right? Rest of them are normally, these two are normally referred to as Aravalli, right? And this is referred to as Delhi Ridge, which is an extension of Delhi Ridge. So this is an extension of our Aravallis into the northern areas or north Indian plains, you can say. Right. So huge. This is one of the oldest of the mountain systems that you can see, and the southernmost point of it, right somewhere here, you have the highest peak, which is named as Guru Shikhar, right? Somewhere around 1721 or 22 meters high, right? There is a place called Mount Abu here, right? And on top of it, you'll also find a lake, which is called Lake Nakhi. Right, Nakhi. So the story is that this was created by Lord Indra and his team with nails, right? Your fingernails, that is Nakh means nails, right? So this is a very interesting lake which gets frozen during the winter season, right? So you can do ice skating in case you are interested. Yeah. And another interesting thing is, so where this first Aravalli, this one ends, so somewhere here you'll find your another interesting lake called Sambar Lake, right? Very close to that, in that it is not in between, so in that gap area only it comes. So Sambar Lake is there, right? So within the Aravalli section, and west of Aravallis, you know, it is the you have the desert area, and as we move towards the west, it becomes more and more sandy, right? Very sandy kind of this excess. So you can go up to, actually you can go across this and go up to Jaisalmer, and after that it is entirely desertic areas, right? Now these are highly a very old region of India, and these are mineral rich as well. So you'll find some of the well-known minerals like copper, zinc, lead, silver, etc. come from this particular area. Right? So there are so many mines that are very important here. You can search through and you'll get some of these mines as well. Right, important region as such. And the rocks that you will find vary from sedimentary to metamorphic rocks, because a lot of processes have undergone this particular area. So you have Precambrian material to the recent alluvial deposits after erosion. So you'll find lots of these materials that are there in this. And this entire system, we say it as the system or the orogeny is named as, or the formation of this particular system is named as Aravalli-Delhi orogeny. So this was the orogeny when because of which the entire mountains were created. And so this is about this one. So it is basically near about barren. You'll find exposed rocks. Wind erosion is very high. You'll find very beautifully shaped rocks there because of wind. Very interesting place to visit. Right. So you can think about. So it is the distance is about I think 700 kilometers or so from its southernmost to the northernmost point. Average height is somewhere around 500 meters. Right. The southern side, as we move towards the southern side, it keeps on, the height keeps on increasing. Right. And there are lots of heritage locations on top of it, which is very interesting to see as well. Right. Towards the
നെറ്റ്വർക്ക് ഇഷ്യൂസ് അതുപോലെ തന്നെ ഈ ഫോൺ ചാർജ് ഒക്കെ പലരും പ്രശ്നം പറയുന്നുണ്ട് കേട്ടോ സാർ.
ഓക്കെ സോ ലെറ്റ്സ് സീ ലെറ്റ്സ് വിൽ ഫിനിഷ് ഇറ്റ് ഓഫ് ഇൻ അനദർ 15 മിനിറ്റ്സ് ഓഫ് ടൈം.
റൈറ്റ് സാർ. ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ ടേക്ക് കെയർ.
റൈറ്റ് ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ. Now, we'll quickly go down to the Vindhyan region, right? Now, again, these are very important things. Vindhyas, they do stretch north of. So you have the Narmada here, right? Narmada, and then you have river Tapi, right? So these are two rivers which are very important. So this may not be this long. Okay, so again, as I was saying, Vindhyas are the Apuap mountains, and normally this region again is asked by them. So there is another small range of it which is lying just north of it, which is normally referred to as Vindhyachal, but as such this is entire thing combinedly is normally referred to as Vindhyan mountains. Right, south of it you'll find, just south of it, there are two rivers basically. One is Son, and Son is on the southern side of it, and river Ton, T-O-N, Ton on the northern side. You have the mountain or the hills called Kaimur Hills, right? So this is again very important. Now, normally these hills along with the hills of Satpura and Rajmahal normally are asked as asked for alignments, right? North south alignments, etc. You'll find them in lots of question papers, right? So this again, as I said, it's upwarped mountain. Lot of plumes coming up, but it doesn't pour out, and it gets it transforms. Actually, there are lots of metamorphosed rocks here. So you'll find marble, which is very commonly found along the Rift Valley region in Narmada, and that is due to this particular reason, because of plumes coming out and settling down in this particular area, right? So that is one. Then you have the Satpuras. Normally this Satpura mountains, you will find they ask for east-west alignments, which includes interestingly seven different hills, right? So you have, I think, six or seven different hills. So it starts off, it is in between, remember, it is in between the Narmada and Tapi or Tapti, right? So it starts off with Rajpipla hills. So it starts off as Rajpipla hills. Then, which is a little longer, right? Continues as Mahadeo Hills. This is Mahadeo Hills. I am just writing M, Mahadeo Hills. And in between these two streams of head streams of River Tapi, you have Gavilgar Hills. Right, Gavilgar Hills, and one of the tributaries. So I'll change the hue color. So this Narmada has a major tributary which is lying coming like this. And here you have two oblique kind of mountain which is called as Maikala Range, right? Maikala Range, Maikal or Maikala, right? So this is very important again. And then you have a little more east of it, you have another circular hill, right, which is referred to as Ramgar Hills. Ramgar Hills. So these are what you call part of. Entirely, this entire complex is considered to be part of Satpura mountain group, right? So very important from perspective of questions that are asked from this particular section. Then in between you also have the Amarkantak. Somewhere here you have the Amarkantak also, which actually is a meeting spot for the Satpuras and the plateau here, right? Satpuras and the Vindhyas as such, right? Now south of it, south of the Tapi, you'll find the Western Ghats start off, right? So where the Western Ghats start off, there is a hill range which runs south, right? This is again very important, right? Satmala, it is called Satmala, right? I'll just write it here, Satmala. So this is I have something else to draw here as well. So Satmala, this is a spur that is running towards east, southeast, you can say, right, from the Western Ghats. Then you have the just south of it, somewhere here you have Ajanta Hills. Again, normally these are in a combination, Ajanta, Satmala, Harishchandra and Bhalghat ranges. Well, normally they are asked in most of the examinations. You'll find Ajanta. Then just little more south of it, you have the Harishchandra. And in between this you have Bhalghat, right? Bhalghat ranges. So this is the Western Ghats, and it goes down south, right? Okay. And Western Ghats does stretch southwards. Now, before we go into the other parts, we can also have a look at the major plateaus here. Because this again is crucial from perspective of your examinations, right? So here you have just north of it, north of our Vindhyas, you have the Malwa, right? I'm just writing this as Malwa. Towards northwest of it, this particular area, you have Mewar. I'm just writing here, Mewar. Then, towards the northeast of this is the Bundelkhand. Bundelkhand. So, then towards east of it is the Bagelkhand. Bagelkhand. And still towards east is the Rohilkhand. Rohilkhand plateau. And towards south of it, you have the Amarkantak area, and east of it, you have our Chotanagpur plateau, right? Which stretches down to this. Now, here in between, also there are few geologists who believe that this area is also a plateau, and they normally call it the Madhya Bharat plateau, right? So, this is also in case. You can remember that it is called the M. I'll just write Madhya Bharat plateau. So that is what they call it, right? So you have Malwa, Mewar, Madhya Bharat plateau, the Bundelkhand, which is mostly a ravine area, right? The Bagelkhand, Rohilkhand, then you have Chotanagpur towards the easternmost part. Just west of this Chotanagpur, you have the Amarkantak plateau and this one. So these are all connected. And south of it, as you know, you have this entire region is normally referred to as Deccan, right? Deccan plateau. Right? You know the formation and such kind of things. The areas south of Deccan is called as Karnataka plateau, right? And towards east is referred to as Telangana plateau. This part. So this is a normal plateau cycle as such, right? So let's. So this I'll just draw this so that it is. So you have the Palghat Gap, right? And just along the gap, you have the Nilgiris. I'll just finish it off as quickly as possible. You have the river Kaveri somewhere here, right, running through. And towards east of it, you have Chevroy Hills. Then you have Javadi, right? Chevroy. You have Javadi Hills. Then where here you have the Lake Pulikat. If you remember, where our ISRO facility and all is there, right? So if you have that, you along this you have the Nallamala mountains, Nallamala, Nallamala, Nallamala goes up to you can say the Krishna delta. So you have Krishna river that is coming in, and then you have the Godavari also. You have a small lake here. This is the freshwater lake called Kolleru, right? Kolleru, and then it continues as Northern Sirkars, right? Northern Sirkars. Then there are few more ranges here which are very important. One is something like this. It's a oblique one, which is referred to as Palconda. I'm just writing that P here, P Palconda. Then you have Seshachalam Hills, right? Seshachalam Hills. Then little more നോർത്ത് ഓഫ് ഇറ്റ് ടുവേർഡ്സ് കൃഷ്ണ യു ഹാവ് ഏരമല ഹിൽസ് ഏരമല ഹിൽസ് ദീസ് ആർ അഗൈൻ വെരി ഇൻട്രസ്റ്റിംഗ് ഏരിയസ് ദൻ ടുവേർഡ്സ് സൗത്ത് യു ഹാവ് അഗൈൻ ആനമലൈ റേഞ്ച് ആനമലൈ സോ ഇഫ് യു ആർ സ്റ്റാൻഡിംഗ് ഹിയർ ഇൻ ദി പാൽഘാട്ട് ഗ്യാപ് യു വിൽ ഫൈൻഡ് So let's imagine this is the Palghat gap. So you'll find the Nilgiris in this condition. It is oblique. It is not in this manner, right? So remember, it is in this condition. So what we are seeing is that in oblique. So Anamalai is also something like this in oblique. Then it goes down right into the southernmost part. So there is a range which is running parallel to the gap, right? Palghat gap axis. So this. Again, somewhere around 34 km gap, right? So details can be discussed sometime later. Then south of it, you have after Anamalai, you have the Cardamom Hills, right? Cardamom Hills, which is again very important. So you have Anamalai Hills, and Cardamom Hills. So this is if you ask me the highest points, you know that Western Ghats the highest point is Anaimudi. And normally what happens is the second highest point is normally referred to as Doddabetta, which it is not likely because Doddabetta is the highest point for Nilgiris, right? So and there are many other peaks which are higher than Doddabetta in the Anamalai region itself. So we cannot say the second highest peak for Western Ghats is Doddabetta. Right, so remember that you can check topo sheets, especially of the Sidiki region, to confirm, because that is the Survey of India information and nothing better than that to confirm. And similarly, you have the Eastern Ghats. Eastern Ghats also, normally, if you ask anyone, you will find they will say Eastern Ghats, the highest peak is Mahendragiri, and most of the books carry that only, right? So Mahendragiri is I don't know whether we can call it the highest peak even in northern Sirkas region, because there are many other peaks like Armakonda, Gallikonda, Saikram Gutta, right? So these are all above 1600 meters, and Mahendragiri is only I think somewhere around 1500 meters or so. So there are many other things as well which needs to be looked into. So these things, the height wise and all, sometimes does create a lot of confusion, so you can be careful with that. You can do more references can be looked into, right? So these are again these two regions, especially the Western Ghats and the Eastern Ghats portions, are some of the oldest as such, because you will find the northern part of Western Ghats, you'll find it has stratigraphic correlation with what has happened in Deccan Plateau region. So most of the edge areas and all, you can find the layerings or stratigraphic layerings. But as we go towards the south, you'll find rocks from Precambrian period exist here. Right, and towards the eastern part, you'll find rocks from Gondwana period can be found here. Right, so these are otherwise also very rich regions in this one. So this is you have lots of iron ore mines, coal mines, etc. here. So if you remember these things, it will be really good. So what I'll do is we'll stop here, right? So that I hope I have covered nearly more than 44 of those hills that are there. I'll just end my slideshow. So thank you for patient listening, and I hope this was really beneficial to you as such, and hope you will be able to use this in your examination as such. Okay. So ending my slideshow, and we can go live as such. Okay, Vinayak, it is over to you. Right, okay. In case anyone has any questions and all, we can look at that.
So it is a question answer section. So
anyone can ask doubt regarding these topics.
Sure. Any
you can.
Yeah, okay.
You can free to ask any questions, please.
So those who want to ask questions, you can unmute yourself and ask the question, right?
ഡൗട്ട് ഫ്രീ ആയിട്ട് ചോദിക്കാവുന്നതാണ്. നിങ്ങൾ ഇപ്പം ക്ലാസ് കേട്ടേണ്ട ഇതില് ഇപ്പൊ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഇതില്ലെങ്കിൽ നമുക്ക് നെക്സ്റ്റ് സെക്ഷനില് സാറിന്റെ അടുത്ത സെക്ഷനിലും വേണമെങ്കിൽ നമുക്ക് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഡൗട്ട്സ് ക്ലിയർ ചെയ്യാവുന്നതാണ്. ആർക്കും ഇപ്പം ആരെയും കാണുന്നില്ല പുറത്ത്. സോ താങ്ക് യു സർ, താങ്ക് യു. സ്പെൻഡിങ് യുവർ വാല്യബിൾ ടൈം വിത്ത് C4SS ആൻഡ് ആൾസോ ഐ നോ ദ ടൈം ഹാസ് ബീൻ ലിറ്റിൽ ബിറ്റ് that we are expected and more. So we can conclude the section. And I know there's a somewhat bored sections aavarundu sadharana ingane karyam namukku arya physical india nu parayumba thanne adile korchukka dry subject aanu, but as I know sir have chosen the study through maps, the physical setup study through maps eduthathu kondu thanne korchudi namukku interesting aayittalle learning by doing nammal eppozhum parayum. I don't know how many have done the map work with sir. If sir kuda cheyda etra per undu enikku ariyathilla, but angane cheyengil ninga I am sure that you won't forget these things in your future. Adalengil you can you will be very endana nalla reethiyil idu end cheyan pattu oru vaada exams ne prayojana padna reethiyil ഈ മാപ്പ് വർക്കിലൂടെ തന്നെ ചെയ്തു കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ അല്ലെ. എനിക്കറിയാം കാര്യം ഇത്രയും എക്സ്റ്റെൻഡ് ആയി പോയത് ഈ സെക്ഷൻ കാര്യം ഇത്രയും എക്സ്പീരിയൻസ് ആയിട്ട് ഒരു റിസോഴ്സ് പേഴ്സൺ നമുക്ക് ഇതുവരെ അങ്ങനെ കിട്ടിയിട്ടില്ല. അപ്പൊ അതുകൊണ്ട് തന്നെ ഈ ഒരു രീതിയിലുള്ള ഒരു എക്സ്പ്ലനേഷൻ നമുക്ക് ഈവൻ നമ്മുടെ അക്കാഡമിക് ടൈമിൽ പോലും കിട്ടി കാണത്തില്ല. അപ്പൊ അതെനിക്ക് ഷുവറാണ്. സോ ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള സെക്ഷൻസ് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഇനിയും പ്രതീക്ഷിക്കാം. നമ്മള് ഒരു ഡോണ്ട് തിങ്ക് ദിസ് ക്ലാസസ് ആസ് എ വെബിനാർ. ഇത് നമ്മള് ഓരോ ടൈം ടേബിൾ ഷെഡ്യൂൾ വെച്ചിട്ടായിരിക്കും C4SS നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ക്ലാസസ് പ്രൊവൈഡ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. ആൾസോ ഒരു എന്താണ് എല്ലാത്തിനെയും എക്സ്പേർട്ട് ടോക്ക് നമ്മൾ ഓരോന്നിനും തരുന്നതായിരിക്കും. നിങ്ങളുടെ വിലയേറിയ നിർദ്ദേശങ്ങൾ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് നൽകാവുന്നതാണ്. ഇഫ് നീഡ് എ ക്ലാസ് ഫോർ എനി സ്പെഷ്യൽ ടോപ്പിക്സ് യു ക്യാൻ സജസ്റ്റ് ടു അസ്. സോ വി വിൽ പ്രൊവൈഡ് ദോസ് സബ്ജക്ട്സ്. അപ്പൊ അതുപോലെ തന്നെ സാറിന്റെയും ഇനി നമുക്ക് നല്ല ക്ലാസസ് ഇനിയും പ്രതീക്ഷിക്കാം. അതുപോലെ തന്നെ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് എന്ത് ഡൗട്ട് ഉണ്ടെങ്കിലും ഞങ്ങളോട് ഓൺലൈൻ ക്ലാസ്സിൽ അറിയാം പല ടെക്നിക്കൽ ഇഷ്യൂസ് ഉണ്ട്. അതിനെ ഞങ്ങൾ ഖേദിക്കുന്നു. കാര്യം നമ്മളെല്ലാം ഇത് ന്യൂ ആണ്. ഇപ്പൊ കുറച്ച് മന്ത്രായിട്ടേ നമ്മൾ ഈ ഓൺലൈനിൽ കൂടുതലായിട്ട് സുലഭമാവുന്നുള്ളൂ. അതുകൊണ്ട് തന്നെ പല ടെക്നിക്കൽ ഇഷ്യൂസും ഈവൻ ഞാൻ പറയുന്നത് ഇപ്പൊ ബ്രേക്ക് ചെയ്ത് കേൾക്കുന്നുണ്ടായിരിക്കാം. അങ്ങനെയുള്ള പല ഇഷ്യൂസും നിങ്ങൾക്ക് നേരിടുന്നുണ്ട്. അപ്പം അതില് നമുക്കിപ്പോ ഒന്നും ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റത്തില്ല. കാര്യം അതിൽ അതുകൊണ്ട് കുറച്ചെങ്കിലും നമ്മൾ പറ്റുന്ന രീതിയിൽ ലൈവ് ക്ലാസ്. കാര്യം ഞാൻ ഇത്രയും പറയാൻ കാര്യം നമുക്ക് ഏകദേശം 135 പ്ലസ് പാർട്ടിസിപ്പൻസ് ഉണ്ട്. ബട്ട് ഉള്ളി ലെസ് ദാൻ ഹാഫ് ഓർ ഹാഫ് ഹാവ് പാർട്ടിസിപ്പേറ്റഡ്. സ്റ്റാർട്ടിംഗ് കുറച്ചുണ്ടായിരുന്നു, പിന്നെ കുറെ പേര് പോയി. പല ഇഷ്യൂസും കാണുമായിരിക്കും. നിങ്ങൾക്ക് അറിയാം ഈവൻ വി ക്യാൻ ഹാവ് എ ടീ ഓർ എനി ഹാവ് എ ഫുഡ് ഡ്യൂറിംഗ് ദീസ് ക്ലാസ്. അപ്പൊ ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള സമയത്ത് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് എന്തെങ്കിലും ബുദ്ധിമുട്ടുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ലീവ് ചെയ്യാതെ അതിന്റെ ഇടയിൽ അത് തന്നെ ചെയ്തങ്ങ് പോവാ. പിന്നെ നിങ്ങളുടെ കൺവീനിയന്റ് ടൈം ഞാൻ ഗൂഗിൾ ഫോംസ് പ്രൊവൈഡ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. സോ യു ക്യാൻ ഹാവ് യുവർ ഫീഡ്ബാക്ക് ദെയർ. ആൾസോ നിങ്ങളുടെ കൺവീനിയന്റ് ടൈം നിങ്ങൾക്ക് സജസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്യാം, നമ്മൾ അതനുസരിച്ച് പ്രൊവൈഡ് ചെയ്യുന്നോളൂ. ഒരുപാട് ക്ലാസ് കൊടുത്തിട്ട് കാര്യമില്ലെന്ന് നമുക്കറിയാം. അതുകൊണ്ട് തന്നെ കൺവീനിയന്റ് ടൈമിൽ വേണ്ട സബ്ജക്ട്സിന്റെ വേണ്ട ടോപ്പിക്സിന്റെ കവറേജ് മാത്രമേ ഞങ്ങൾ നൽകാറുള്ളൂ നിങ്ങൾക്ക്. സോ ഇതൊരു ബേർഡൻ ആയിട്ട് എടുക്കാതെ നിങ്ങൾ മാക്സിമം ഞങ്ങൾ ആരെയും ഫോഴ്സും ചെയ്യുന്നില്ല. നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഇഷ്ടമുള്ള ക്ലാസ്സസ് നല്ല രീതിയിൽ കണ്ട് പാർട്ടിസിപ്പൻസ് നല്ല രീതിയിൽ വരണം. ഇപ്പൊ പാർട്ടിസിപ്പേറ്റ് ചെയ്തവർ തന്നെ എന്തെങ്കിലും ഞങ്ങൾക്ക് സജഷൻസ് ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് പറയാം, ഇപ്പൊ പറയാം, ഇല്ലെങ്കിൽ പിന്നീട് ഞങ്ങളെ അറിയിക്കാം. അതുപോലെ തന്നെ സാറിനെ പോലെ നല്ല എക്സ്പേർട്ട് ആയിട്ടുള്ളവരെ കൊണ്ട് ഞങ്ങൾ വീണ്ടും ക്ലാസ് എടുപ്പിക്കുന്നതാണ്. ഇത് നല്ല രീതിയിൽ സാറിനെ എനിക്ക് വളരെയധികം നന്ദിയുണ്ട് സാർ. ഇത്രയും കാര്യം ഇത്ര നീണ്ടു പോകുന്നത് അത്രയും ടോപ്പിക് സാർ കവർ ചെയ്തുകൊണ്ട് തന്നെയാണ്. കാര്യം ഇത്രയും ഡീറ്റെയിൽ ആയിട്ട് വേറെ എവിടെയും നമുക്ക് ഈവൻ ഒരു യൂട്യൂബ് വീഡിയോയിൽ നോക്കിയാൽ പോലും ഒറ്റ ഇതിൽ നമുക്ക് ഇങ്ങനെ കാണാൻ സാധിക്കത്തില്ല. അപ്പൊ അത്രയും ഡീറ്റെയിൽ ആയിട്ട് ഞങ്ങൾക്ക് ഞങ്ങളുടെ ഇനാഗുലർ സെക്ഷനിൽ തന്നെ സാറിനെ കിട്ടിയാൽ വളരെയധികം നന്ദിയുണ്ട്. C4SS നന്ദിയും കടപ്പാടും സാറിനെ അറിയിക്കുന്നു. സാറിന്റെ ഇനിയും ഇതേപോലുള്ള വാല്യബിൾ സെക്ഷൻസ് സാറിന്റെയും ടൈം നമുക്കറിയാം, പ്രിഷ്യസ് ടൈമാണ്. ഞങ്ങളുടെ എല്ലാവരുടെയും ഇതിന്റെ ഇടയിൽ ഞങ്ങളുടെ കൂടെ ജോയിൻ ചെയ്ത് ഈ ഒരു ക്ലാസ് ഇനാഗ്രേഷൻ ചെയ്തതിന് എന്റെ പേരിലും C4SS പേരിലും ഇന്ന് പങ്കെടുത്ത എല്ലാ പാർട്ടിസിപ്പൻസിന്റെ പേരിലും സാറിനെ താങ്ക്സ് നന്ദി കടപ്പാട് അറിയിക്കുന്നു.
ഓക്കെ സാർ, അപ്പം നെക്സ്റ്റ് സെക്ഷൻ നമ്മുടെ അടുത്ത ഷെഡ്യൂൾ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് 14th ദിസ് ഫ്രൈഡേ ആണ്. ടൈം 3 PM തന്നെയാണ്. ഇഫ് ഇനി എനി എന്താണ് ഇൻകൺവീനിയൻസ് ഫോർ എനി പാർട്ടിസിപ്പൻസ് പ്ലീസ് ഫ്രീ ടു ടെൽ അസ്. സോ നമ്മൾ ഇപ്പൊ ഷെഡ്യൂൾ ചെയ്തേക്കുന്നത് 14th ഒരു ക്ലാസ് ഉണ്ട്. ടൈം ടേബിള് ബാക്കി ഷെഡ്യൂളും എല്ലാം നമ്മുടെ ഗ്രൂപ്പിലിടും. ഇന്ന് പങ്കെടുത്തവർ തീർച്ചയായും അടുത്ത ക്ലാസ്സുകൾ, അതായത് ഇതൊരു ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞ ഒരു വെബിനാർ പോലെ കാണാതെ നമ്മൾ ഡിസംബർ വരെ മാക്സിമം ക്ലാസ്സസ് നമ്മൾ എക്സ്പേർട്ടിനെ കൊണ്ടും അല്ലാതുള്ള മോക്ക് ടെസ്റ്റും അതുപോലെ തന്നെ അല്ലാതുള്ള ഡിസ്കഷൻസ് എല്ലാം നമ്മൾ നടത്തുന്നതായിരിക്കും. സോ എല്ലാവരും ഞങ്ങളുടെ കൂടെ തന്നെ കോപ്പറേറ്റ് ചെയ്ത് മുന്നോട്ട് പോകണമെന്ന് ആഗ്രഹിക്കുന്നു.
താങ്ക് യു ഫോർ ദ ഓപ്പർച്യൂണിറ്റി. അത് മാത്രല്ല, അത് എന്താണ് പറയാ, എല്ലാരും ഇത് പ്രാക്ടീസ് ചെയ്യാണ് നടക്കില്ല. പ്രാക്ടീസ് ഈസ് എ മസ്റ്റ് തിങ്. ആൻഡ് ഐ വാസ് നോട്ട് ഹാവിംഗ് എനി റിസോഴ്സ്. എന്റെ അടുത്ത് ഇപ്പൊ തൽക്കാലം ഒരു റിസോഴ്സും ഇല്ലാത്തൊരു സിറ്റുവേഷൻ എന്നാണ് ഞാൻ ഇത് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. മുഖ്യവാറും എല്ലാം നമ്മളെ മെറ്റീരിയൽസ് എല്ലാം പാലക്കാടാണ് കിടക്കുന്നത്. റൈറ്റ്, സോ വട്ട് എവർ ഐ കുഡ് ഗ്യാദർ ഫ്രം നോളജ് ഐ ഹാവ്. സോ റൈറ്റ്, അങ്ങനെ ഒരു ജസ്റ്റ് ഒരു പേപ്പറിൽ എഴുതി ഉണ്ടാക്കിയിട്ടാണ് നമ്മളിത് ചെയ്തത്. റൈറ്റ്, ബിക്കോസ് വി ഹാവ് ഓൾറെഡി വി ഹാവ് എ ഡീറ്റെയിൽഡ് സിലബസ് ഇൻ PG കാലിക്കറ്റ് യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റിന്റെ സിലബസ് എടുത്ത് നോക്കിക്കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ അറിയാം. നൗ ഇതിനെ കുറച്ച് കൂടുതൽ വേണമെങ്കിൽ ഞാൻ ഇന്ന് കവർ ചെയ്ത് കംപ്ലീറ്റ്, ദർ ഇസ് എ ബുക്ക് ബൈ NBT പബ്ലിക്കേഷന്റെ ഫിസിക്കൽ ജിയോളജി ഓഫ് ഇന്ത്യ. വളരെ സിമ്പിൾ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ബുക്കാണ്, നാഷണൽ ബുക്ക് ട്രസ്റ്റ് പബ്ലിഷ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു സംഭവമാണ്. അത് ഇറ്റ് ഡസന്റ് കോസ്റ്റ് മച്ച്, മേ ബി 100 rupees ഓ 200 rupees എന്തോ ഉള്ളൂ അതിന് കോസ്റ്റ്. ബട്ട് ദിസ് ഇസ് സംതിങ് ദാറ്റ് എവ്രി ജോഗ്രഫർ ഫ്രം ഇന്ത്യ ഹാസ് ടു റീഡ്. ഇതൊന്നും വായിക്കാതെ ഒരിക്കലും അറിയില്ല എന്താണ് എന്താണ് പറയുക ഇന്ത്യൻ സബ് കോണ്ടിനെന്റ് എന്ന് പറയുന്നത്. ആൻഡ് ഇഫ് എനിവൺ വാണ്ട്സ് ടു അണ്ടർസ്റ്റാൻഡ് ദ ഒറിജിൻ ഓഫ് ഇറ്റ്, യു ഷുഡ് റീഡ് ദി ബുക്ക് ബൈ പ്രണയ് ലാൽ, വിച്ച് ഇസ് കോൾഡ് ഇൻഡിക്ക. റൈറ്റ്, വളരെ വളരെ ഇൻട്രസ്റ്റിംഗ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു എന്താണ് പറയുക കംപ്ലീറ്റ് ബയോജോഗ്രഫിക്കൽ എവല്യൂഷനെ കുറിച്ച് സംസാരിക്കുന്ന ഒരു ബുക്കാണ്. സോ ദ പീപ്പിൾ ഹാവ് ടു റീഡ് സോ ദാറ്റ് ദേ ക്യാൻ എക്സ്പാൻഡ് ആൻഡ് ബിക്കം റിയൽ ജോഗ്രഫേഴ്സ് എന്നുള്ളത്. ആൻഡ് ദെൻ ഗോ ആൻഡ് സീ ദ പ്ലേസസ്. റൈറ്റ്, മുഖ്യമാറി ഈ പറഞ്ഞിട്ടുള്ള സ്ഥലങ്ങളൊക്കെ ഞാൻ പോയിട്ട് നേരിട്ട് കണ്ടിട്ടുള്ള ഒരാളാണ്. ആൻഡ് മൈ ആഫ്റ്റർ മൈ PG ദിസ് വാസ് മൈ മെയിൻ ഹോബി ടു ഗോ വാക്ക് അറൌണ്ട് ആൻഡ് സീ. സോ വട്ട് എവർ ഐ സെഡ് ഇസ് ഫ്രം ദോസ് എക്സ്പീരിയൻസസ്. ഇന്നിപ്പോ എന്റെ അടുത്ത് റിസോഴ്സസ് ഇല്ലായിരുന്നു, ഓർ എൽസ് ഇറ്റ് കുഡ് ഹാവ് ബിക്കം മോർ ഇൻട്രസ്റ്റിംഗ് ദാൻ വട്ട് വി ഡിഡ് ടുഡേ. താങ്ക് യു. എനിവേ, ഇറ്റ് വിൽ ബി ഗുഡ് ടു കളക്ട് ഫീഡ്ബാക്സ്. ഫീഡ്ബാക്സ് കളക്ട് ചെയ്യുന്നത് നന്നായിരിക്കും, സോ ദാറ്റ് വി ക്യാൻ ഇംപ്രൂവ് അപ്പോൺ ഇറ്റ്. റൈറ്റ്, സോ നോ, വെനെവർ അതർ ഫാക്കൾട്ടീസ് ആർ ഓൾസോ കമ്മിങ്, സോ യു ക്യാൻ ഗിവ് ദം ദസ് ഇൻപുട്സ് ദാറ്റ് ദിസ് ഇസ് വാട്ട് ദി സ്റ്റുഡൻസ് ഹാവ് റിക്വസ്റ്റഡ് ഫോർ. സോ ആ ഒരു ലെവലിലേക്ക് പോവാം. പിന്നെ വേണമെങ്കിൽ നമുക്ക് ക്ലാസ്സസ് കട്ട് ഷോർട്ട് ചെയ്തിട്ട് 40 മിനിറ്റ്സിന്റെ ഡ്യൂറേഷൻ മാത്രമാക്കാം. എന്നാൽ കുറച്ചും കൂടെ എഫക്റ്റീവ് ആയിട്ട് കുറച്ച് ടൈമിൽ ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റും. ഓക്കെ
സാർ. ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ, താങ്ക് യു സാർ. So all of you can leave now.
Right.
So we will meet at Friday 3 PM next schedule.
Okay.
Okay sir.
Bye bye.
Thank you sir. Thank you. Bye bye.